Hey everyone, it's Nurse Dani coming to you today on Halloween. Happy Halloween. So today we want to talk about Halloween safety, and our guest is Dr. Bowles, and he is an awesome pediatrician in Utah County. Tell us where you practice, what your practice is called, and a little bit about your background.
Okay. My name is Austin Bowles. I grew up in Idaho, southeastern Idaho. I grew up on a ranch there, worked with cows, and somewhere along the way got interested in medicine. I went to USU for my undergraduate.
From delivering those cows, right?
We delivered cows. We did vaccines. People ask why I didn't become a vet, but eventually you learn that it's more interesting to work with people
humans
that can talk to you, and kids especially that are cute. And some of them can talk to you, some of them can't. But eventually ended up at USU, did master's and undergraduate studies there. And then I went to the University of Pittsburgh for medical school, and then finished my training in pediatrics at Primary Children's Hospital in Salt Lake. And now we've started a clinic. We're excited. Intermountain hasn't had primary care pediatrics in Provo before. And now
that's like the birthing capital of the nation.
Yeah.
So we need good pediatricians. We're lucky to have you.
Yeah, we're excited about it. They're at the Utah Valley Clinic. Some people will have seen the big new buildings there on the Utah Valley Hospital campus. There on that in that building, we have the Utah Valley Clinic Pediatrics Group, which I'm helping start. We attend babies that are born at Utah Valley Hospital, at Orem Community Hospital, and some at Timpanogos Regional. And we have a lot of good things going on there. We have laboratory studies that can be drawn on site. We have imaging studies that can be drawn on site.
That's so convenient.
And we have the pediatric subspecialists very close by, which is nice when we need
the experts. You have to refer them to someone. They're not far.
Yeah.
And I can attest to everything that he's saying because I get to work with him too. So you're great. We're really lucky to have you with us today.
Thank you.
So Halloween safety, what is the number one risk to children and families on Halloween?
So one of the concerns a lot of parents have is candy and whether that candy's been tampered with or if there's some unknown danger with the candy, but it's actually pedestrian safety. So motor vehicle accidents, kids are more likely, to be hit by a car on Halloween than any other day, twice as likely on Halloween versus any other day in the year. We have more people on the roads going to parties, coming back from parties. We have a bunch of kids sometimes hidden by costumes crossing the roads. Yeah. We wait till it's nighttime to do all this stuff. So it's a recipe for accidents to happen.
It is. And all they're thinking about is the next house. I just am going to run and get my candy. And they're not thinking about the car that's coming.
They're excited. They're with their friends. They just got a bunch of candy. Some of that candy's been eaten and they just want to run around.
They're buzzing with energy. So distraction is probably the number one thing to focus on. Distraction for pedestrians as well as distraction for drivers. Talk a little bit about that.
So for the pedestrians, we talked about a little bit already, all the distractions that they have. So kids will forget about it often, that you've told them to be safe, to watch both ways or to look both ways. But telling them that beforehand, making sure that they're visible. So we'll talk about costumes a little bit later, but making sure those costumes have reflective tape on them, bright elements that can be seen. Flashlights are a good thing to hand out to kids. I know we don't always think about that, but flashlights can be carried around. Glow stick necklaces, things that make them more visible, things that help them see better and help drivers see them. And then a good pre-game speech telling them to watch where they're going, to cross the road in groups, to cross the road where they're supposed to be crossing, to use the sidewalks. Not everywhere has sidewalks, and so it's always a good time to remind kids when they're walking on the street that doesn't have a sidewalk to walk on the far side of the road facing traffic.
Good advice. So they can see the car coming towards them and they're,
So they can see the car coming towards them and they have time to react in case that car doesn't see them.
So distracted drivers, that's something else to watch about. And even because it sounds like from everything that we're talking about, a lot of people might think, well, if I go with my kids, then they're going to be safe. But parents can get distracted too. You start talking with friends, you're out in groups, you're socializing, you may lose track of your kids, you may be on your phone. So parents need to minimize those distractions as well.
Yeah, parents need to be
on the road and when they're walking.
Absolutely. The cell phones that you brought up are a great thing to have with you in case there's an emergency. Older kids that might want to go trick-or-treating on their own can have a cell phone in case they need to get a hold of their parents, in case they get lost.
You want to be able to find them.
Good for quick pictures to be taken of all the different costumes or different decorations that people have outside their houses, but they can be a distraction. Most of us spend too much time looking at our cell phones, and when we're around a lot of cars that aren't paying attention and kids that are running around. It's important to be aware.
Wait until you get home to post all those pictures on social media.
Exactly.
Yeah, just enjoy the moment and be with your kids.
For drivers, I'd say just be aware that there's all these kids. Know that it's Halloween. Drive somewhat defensively, maybe being aware that other people might not be safe, might not be paying attention. There's different Halloween parties going on, some of which will have alcohol served at them. And so we can't assume every driver out there is going to be safe. So we just need to pay extra careful attention.
Yeah, defensive walking and defensive driving, right? Okay, so number one danger is pedestrian auto accidents. Number two danger that parents should be aware of.
So lacerations actually happen around Halloween. We have the jack-o'-lanterns being carved. And so that's one of the more frequent things that we see at emergency departments around Halloween time is lacerations. There's a lot of different things we can do to be more safe about that. So I know most people aren't carving their jack-o'-lanterns on Halloween. That's already taken place. But for future Halloweens, it's good to remember.
Be aware of that.
Use tools that are designed to carve pumpkins. Less likely to slip. Less likely to have extra sharp blades that don't necessarily need for carving pumpkins.
And they're age appropriate.
Exactly. Age appropriate. So little kids that maybe shouldn't be handling sharp objects can always draw the pattern and then have an older sibling or a parent carve that for them.
Yeah. How about fire safety? Like there's, you know, a lot of people put their jack-o'-lanterns that they've previously carved on their porches and they may have a candle inside. Is fire danger a risk on Halloween?
Yes, we have capes and wigs and other things that can catch fire. We want to make sure we don't have fire waiting to be caught. And so there's a lot of different options and they seem to be getting more popular every year that we have battery operated lights that can be placed in the jack-o'-lanterns. There's glow sticks, which kids love. There's different colors, which makes it a little more creative. So I think those are a great option. We already talked about those for costume brightness. So
get
a set of glow sticks. And
they'll think that's exciting. And you can get them at the dollar store now. They're not expensive and they'll be like, yay, that's awesome. Okay, so food safety. You mentioned at the beginning that everyone's worried about food safety. Talk more about that.
So fortunately, tampering is rare. It's not very common that candy or some other treat has been tampered with and is therefore unsafe. However, we still need to look through the candy that kids are getting. So
No objects slipped in there that shouldn't
either. Yeah, that's the other thing. So one word of advice would be to wait until after the trick-or-treating to eat the candy or to go through the treats. So kids can focus on trick-or-treating and the safety that we already talked about and focus on the candy later. That also gives the parents an opportunity to go through the bag and see what's there. So objects that maybe shouldn't be there.
Also choking hazards for small children.
Yeah, age-appropriate stuff. So
some on their porch is just passing out the same thing to everyone. May not think, I just gave something to a two-year-old that they could choke on.
Yeah, exactly. So looking for hard candies or other things that are a choking hazard.
Are there specific candies that parents should be aware of when it comes to young children and age?
It's hard to say. So there's a lot of different candies out there. So hard candies in particular, I would say being careful with those, making sure that the kids are old enough to handle a hard object that they can't chew beforehand and might swallow. So they need to be old enough to know how to chew and swallow things without just chewing them, knowing that they're safe. And usually that happens beyond 2 years of age. So under two is the big group that's at risk for choking. But even the 3 and 4 year olds, you need to have some extra precaution with.
Like fruit snacks, Starburst, that kind of thing.
Fruit snacks.
Chew it well.
Yeah, exactly.
Choke on it. Okay, so anything else with food safety that you think people should know?
So making sure it's food or age appropriate. Food allergies. We have a lot of kids that have food allergies and we want Halloween to be a fun and safe time for them. So teaching your children if they do have a dietary restriction or an allergy to
choose the appropriate candy if given a choice.
Yes, choose the appropriate candy or politely decline candies that maybe they know aren't appropriate for them. Baked goods or other treats are sometimes offered, trying to accept those only from known neighbors or friends. So you don't want to accept those from strangers. That's another thing to watch out for. The fun size candy bars actually are sometimes made in different factories than the normal sized candy bar. So if we have for example, a Milky Way that a kid with an allergy has tolerated before, they might have a reaction to the fun size. I wouldn't say avoid those universally if that's the case, but to be aware and pay attention for symptoms of an allergic reaction.
If you see that and you're trying to think back to what mm-hmm. it might have been. You know, they didn't eat anything else yeah. that would cause it. Maybe that's a possibility. Mm-hmm. Okay, good to know. What about costumes? What should people keep in mind for that? We talked about making sure they're well lit. Mm-hmm. Anything else that they should be aware of?
Yeah, we focused a lot on making sure drivers could see the kids, uh-huh. but kids need to be able to see too. And masks, hats, wigs are all very popular, but can obstruct vision. So making sure that those masks, if parents choose to wear them or kids choose to wear them, is often the case. Making sure they aren't obstructing their vision, that they can still see where they're going, that they're not wandering into obstacles or oncoming traffic.
Yeah, definitely.
The other thing to watch for, we talked about, is fire. So most costume material should be flame retardant or flame resistant. So looking for that specific label when you're purchasing the costume.
Yeah, that's good advice as well. I learned that the hard way on the 4th of July. Flame retardant pajamas saved my daughter's life, mm-hmm. literally. And I think it, you know, hopefully hearing this could save a child's life on Halloween. A firework malfunctioned and went into the crowd, into us, instead of up in the air. It was a big aerial. And thankfully, because she had on flame retardant pajamas, it hit her thigh and burned a hole there, but it just fizzled right out. She had a few little ash burns on her feet, but nothing else. So
thank goodness
for that. Because she just had like on a cute little cotton sundress prior to that before she changed, mm-hmm. and that would have stuck right to her skin. So yeah, I'm a huge fan of flame retardant yes. material for kids.
Especially wandering around with yeah. pumpkins lit yeah, and other exactly. fire hazards.
Exactly. Or, you know, some... Teenagers are never irresponsible.
Yeah, never.
So maybe they can be walking around with something too and just not see when they're swinging around. So what about makeup? Are there certain precautions like, you know, I've had some discussions with parents about should I or shouldn't I put makeup on my baby? It's fun to dress them up for their mm-hmm. first Halloween, but is there anything they should be aware of?
So makeup's a great option, especially we just talked about masks sometimes being hard mm-hmm. to see in. Makeup gets rid of that risk. However, looking for non-toxic makeups is important. So they should be labeled as such. You can do your own research because there's so many brands of makeup on Amazon or wherever you may be buying them. Doing some research beforehand, making sure it's safe. It's a good idea to try it beforehand in a small area to make sure there's no reaction and you don't have any unpleasant surprises the night of trick-or-treating.
Yeah.
And then in small children, I would take some extra precautions. So babies under one year of age are at extra risk. So
their skin is extra sensitive,
it's extra
right?
sensitive. It is extra absorbent. And they also have more skin compared to their size than older mm-hmm. children or adults. So they're more likely to absorb bad things from whatever it is that's on them. And they're more likely to have a bad reaction to that than other kids as well. So what I would say is I would avoid using makeup under 6 months of age, similar to sunscreen. We want to be mm-hmm. careful with sunscreen in that age group just because we don't have good studies saying each kind of makeup is safe or not safe in that age group. And there's other options when they're small like that, and we can be a little more creative with our costumes.
Yeah.
In the older group, I would just do your research beforehand and make sure that the makeup you choose is a safe one.
Yeah, speaking of non-toxic, I mean, it's right by the mouth, ears, and or mouth, eyes, and nose. Mm-hmm. And so there's lots of different places it could get that would be bad.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I was having a conversation with some moms this morning, and we were talking about wearing the appropriate clothing out for trick-or-treating because it's going to be cold. Mm-hmm. We're in Utah, so I mean, it's going to be pretty cold tonight, and kids are so excited to show off their costumes that they don't want to wear coats and cover it up.
Yeah.
And so a lot of my friends are saying, I just keep telling my kids they're going to catch a cold if they go out without a coat. Is mm-hmm. that a myth or is that true?
That's a myth. It's important to keep our children warm. So we want them to, one, be comfortable and enjoy the activity, mm-hmm. but we also want to keep them warm. But it being cold tonight, like it most likely will and is already getting, isn't a risk for them to get a cold. There's other things going on this time of year that can put them at risk for colds. We're getting into the cold and flu season. We have kids that have been in school now for 2 months or so yes. that are starting to share viruses back and forth. And so we see a general uptick in infections that happen around this time of year. That's not
people are getting
to
together, having parties, just socializing, yeah. interacting more.
A lot more germ sharing and yeah. a lot more colds and flus that come up in kids. Yeah.
Yeah. So anything else that you think that parents should be aware of when it comes to Halloween safety?
We talked about costumes. Another thing to go back to that when you mentioned the makeup being near the eyes to remember is that decorative contacts are getting more and more popular.
Oh, yeah.
So the different eye colors that sometimes go along with part of a costume, those should only be worn if you've kind of gotten approval from an eye doctor. So an optometrist or an ophthalmologist. Those can put children at risk for corneal abrasions, different infections that can lead to inflammation, pain, and sometimes vision loss. So we want to be careful with those. Exactly. Most of the time it works out great. I know a lot of people that have worn them and don't have any issues, but it's a risk that they should know about.
Especially for a child who doesn't really know how to put it in themselves and take care of it. Or if it falls out, they may just like pick it up and put it right back in, not know what they're doing, and it could be contaminated. All good advice and good tips. So hopefully our kids can stay safe this Halloween. Thank you. So anything else?
Yeah, I remembered another thing. So we talked about food safety.
Yeah.
After Halloween, I think is also important. So we have all this candy that the kids want to eat, and dentists and pediatricians everywhere want to make sure we don't eat too much candy.
Yes.
So rationing the candy afterwards. There's different things that have become popular. So the Switch Witch or the Sweet Tooth Fairy or the Treat Fairy.
Explain these because these are new to me.
They're fairly new to me as well. But what basically it is parents take some of the candy and replace it with a healthy option or a toy, which kids will probably be more excited about.
Sure.
So that's a way of making sure the kids aren't getting too much candy all at once. So you can spread it out a little bit more. They can still be excited that they were able to trade something in for something that's still fun. They get the mythology that goes along with having a Switch Witch or a Sweet Tooth Fairy that's around. So rationing out the candy is, I think, an important thing. We don't want the kids eating all the candy the next day or the night of. It can be a good idea to eat a good, healthy meal before going out trick-or-treating so that they're not full. They don't want to sit there and eat everything after, as soon as they get it.
Yeah. When I was a kid, I remember I was probably about 7 or 8, and my goal and my friend's goal was to fill up a pillowcase of candy, and we met our goal. We were out till like 10:30. We were the annoying kids knocking on the door late, but we filled it up. And I, like, after that, my goal was to see how long it could last, but that's not a lot of kids' approach. They just want to eat it as fast as they can, and I ended up throwing some away by Christmas because it was stale and nasty. But you know, with my kids, when they come home, they all switch it to, and, you know, trade, like, I want this, and they take from each other and switch it around. But then a couple of years ago, after they'd done that, I went and put their bags away. This was when my son was about 3. And I came back downstairs later, and I found him like shoulder deep in the candy bag, just eating it. First I had to take a picture because it was just so cute. But then after that, you know, it was like, well, okay, we need to find a different hiding spot because he's not the one who's going to ration it. He'll just eat it as fast as he can. So that's a Switch Witch.
Yeah, I like the idea.
That's awesome.
Witch. That can make it a little more fun, easier to ration out the candy.
Yeah.
Tough on the parents still because I know my dad ate a lot of my candy when I was younger.
Yeah.
And I can see myself getting it out of control with the candy. So it's good for everybody to remember this time
and leftovers.
Ration. Yeah. Watch the leftovers. Brush your teeth good after all the candy.
Yeah. So food safety, probably the best part to think about is after.
Yeah, after. Yeah. There's a lot going on.
Anything else?
No,
I think people should know.
I think we've covered a lot of the Halloween safety tips. It can be a dangerous holiday. Like every holiday, we see injuries that happen, but we want it to be a fun and safe and healthy activity. We aren't telling people to not go out and trick or treat. We want everyone to have fun, just to take some reasonable precautions and be careful.
Lots of good tips and advice. I hope that all of your kids are safe this Halloween and that you have so much fun. Thank you for joining us. And of course, if you have questions for me, you know where to find me on Facebook. You can send me a message anytime and I'll answer it as soon as I'm available. And we'll catch you for a live stream next time. Thanks. Have a great day. Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.